I'm Kelly from Nympherno, interviewing for Total Rock Radio here at Hellfest, and I'm very lucky to be with Brutal Truth. So, you guys have been together since 1990.
Well, we had a long hiatus from 98 to 2006, but so we were together for 2 8-year spans with an 8-year hiatus, strangely enough.
So it's really interesting. I mean, you must be looking at the music scene from two very different periods of time. How's it changed?
Well, the internet certainly changed a lot of stuff, and also home recording technology. They've combined to make labels almost fucking obsolete, unfortunately, because everybody's downloading shit, and you don't need a $20,000 budget anymore to do a record. You just fucking go to somebody who has Pro Tools and a few microphones. So, but musically, I suppose it's gotten a tad more generic, which can't be helped when a genre's been around that long. But it's really cool to see kids today in bands who were probably 2 years old when Extreme Conditions came out, playing in grind bands now, and they're 20. And it's really cool to see the music, you know, thrash metal too, the music that you play have that kind of longevity, because I think it makes it valid. I mean, who's going to give a fuck about Limp Bizkit in 10 years, huh?
Potentially, yeah. You guys are you've been around so long, so you're a bit of an authority on grind. And there's a lot of subgenres in grind now. Like, a lot. I was reading up on it. It's quite ridiculous. Like, loads and loads and loads. Do you think that's legitimate, or do you think that's kind of a strange product of the internet, that all the subcategories?
It might start as legitimate, but then it kind of just devolves, just because everybody has to categorize and pigeonhole everything. I mean, sure, you've got gore grinds and porn grind.
Porno grind. Shocking.
Yeah, I mean,
Apple core.
I mean, you've got the Eastern European bands that are much more gory and everything, and then originally grind was more of a kind of socio-political thing, and it still is in a number of ways, but I think a lot of people in death metal got into grindcore, so they kept their kind of death metal values, which was just singing about gore or whatever, and just speeding up musically.
I was reading a lot of your lyrics, and I noticed that they are really politically aware, and also a lot of them sort of around environmental issues and capitalism and stuff like that, and I thought it was really cool, and I just wondered, you know, where you kind of draw your influences from for that, and what kind of makes you want to move in that direction. Do you think it's important in extreme music to be aware?
Well, yeah, sure. I mean, I can't answer all that directly because I'm not the lyricist, but I can say in general that I think it's cool to have lyrics that mean something. I mean, I really have no problem with people like Brutal Truth just because we're fast as fuck and really intense and people don't care about the lyrics or something, as long as they're not if you're gonna have lyrics, then you might as well have something instead of just a bunch of grunting and screaming and shit. And we grew up on a lot of hardcore and stuff, punk, so, and metal, of course, but that's really what grind is, which is kind of a combination of all that shit. So, you know, it is important to have that stuff because people can get something out of it cool. And like I said, if they don't, if they just like us because we fucking play like we're on fire, that's fine too.
Awesome. So I heard a rumor that you guys are going to disband at the end of the year, or towards the end of the year.
That's my fault.
Oh.
I'm going to semi-retire.
Oh, yeah?
I want semi-retire.
To make that very clear, semi.
Well, what it is I'm not going to do Brutal Truth anymore, but I'm still in four other fucking bands. Mm-hmm. So Venomous Concept will still come over here. Once in a while, I play bass for a lockup and Embry can't do it. I play in two local bands where I live, a black metal band, Nocturnal Hellstorm, and a grindcore band called Blurring, featuring Eric Burke on drums, who used to play in Brutal Truth, so you get that whole incestuous thing.
Awesome.
I'm in a project band with some guys from Norway and Sweden called Nunfuck Ritual. So what it is that I'm just not going to be traveling as much.
Yeah.
I'm still going to be doing stuff, but more just at a relaxed pace.
So the things that influenced, the bands that influenced you in sort of the 1990s, I mean, how do they differ to the bands that influence you now? Like maybe the top 3 to 5 from the 1990s against, you know, the bands you listen to now?
we haven't had direct influences since like 1994. We were just been on autopilot. We just absorbed everything we needed, and then we just smoke a lot of weed and write crazy shit. So when we came back, we were still on auto. It's hard to describe. It's like we soaked up all the influences we needed, and now we just have full filing cabinets, and we don't need any more input, and we just fucking rip a bunch of bong hits and go, I got a riff. And at the beginning, we were influenced by death metal, punk, hardcore, grindcore. Mm-hmm. You know, stuff that was on Earache, shit like Dark Angel, a lot of different shit. But like I said, we've been self-powered for a long time.
Awesome. So what's the creative process like with you guys? Do you just jam and just see what comes out, or do people bring different bits together and say, hey, listen to this, this is what I've done, and you build on it from there? Or,
well, we don't live in the same cities. Mm-hmm. Well, we're not going to be writing anymore anyway, but yeah. When we did write, I have like a little home studio on my Mac, so I can use like recording software to program fake drums. Mm-hmm. And then play guitar and bass, send an MP3 out to the guys and go, check this song out, and they'll go, cool, send me the notes. And then I have to, very fucking tedious with all the notes we have. Yeah, F sharp, A, G, you know. And the drums, it's just, like I said, programmed. Excellent. So Rich could just listen to that and cop it.
So with the semi-retirement,
yes.
What are you hoping to have more time for? Just the other bands, or is there...
It's that, and it's also, I may not look it, but I'm going to be 50 in October.
Get out.
Yeah.
See, rock and roll metal keeps you young.
That's true. All that virgin blood didn't hurt. I just want to have a little more stability in my life. I'm still going to play in bands and do stuff. It's just like going to be a little more on my schedule. And I'll miss some of it, but I'm still going to travel. It's just not going to be as much.
Excellent. So what's on the horizon for the rest of the year then? Where are you guys at next?
We have one more show in the European continent in the middle of July at the infamous Obscene Extreme Festival in Trutnov, Czech Republic.
Cool.
And Nastrovi. So far there's only one show booked in the States at a festival in Denver August 3rd, but there's going to be more stuff in early October, after Brazil. We're going to Brazil for a few shows.
How
then
exciting.
We are going to Japan and possibly other Pacific areas.
Yeah.
After Thanksgiving. Well, American Thanksgiving. I don't know if it's the same shit here.
Wonderful. And what's been your favorite place to play in Europe so far?
Ooh, that's a difficult one.
I'm all of the tough questions today.
Well, no, it's not that. It's just that I don't want to... I mean, we had a great show in Copenhagen, but then we played Barcelona last night, and that was fucking insane. I don't want to slight anybody. you know, you expect people to go Amsterdam because I get to smoke a lot of weed. You know, been there, done that, you know. Just anywhere where they freak the fuck out, I guess.
Do you find the audiences are quite different in Europe against, like, America?
Somewhat, they might be a little more enthusiastic, but that's also a geographical thing. The further you come to play somewhere, the more psyched they are, because they're like, I can't see these guys every day.
The more special you are to them.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, if we play 100 miles from somewhere where we live, they'd be like, oh, cool. Go check those guys out.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
And I saw online that you guys hold a world record.
Is that still, or did Napalm break it?
I think it might still be you guys. According to Wikipedia, you've still got it at 2 seconds, or 2.18 seconds, world's shortest music video.
Have you ever seen it?
No, I should check it out, obviously. But I heard 48 images in quick succession.
Well, as long as the Wi-Fi works here, I'll show you when we're done.
Awesome, sounds good. What was the inspiration for it?
The video or the song in the first place?
The video.
Actually, a good friend of mine did that for us. Now, this is back in like 92 when people... He just did it. He had to go to a real editing suite. He didn't just have fucking Adobe Premiere or Apple Final Cut. And he stitched together. We were talking about that 2-second video, right? Let's see. That would be 32 frames because there's one for every kick and snare.
Awesome.
And the song... Oh, is it over?
She's letting me know that we need to go and watch that music video in a minute. That's what she's saying.
Okay.
We're going to watch that.
Well, you can edit that later with Adobe Premiere. Okay, the point being that one day my friend, who was always videoing us at shows, goes, hey, you might like this, and just gives me a videotape, you know, an actual VHS back in the day.
Wow.
And I went home and stuck it in there and went, holy fuck. So we sent it to Eric and said, we made a video. And they were like, holy shit, and they sent it to MTV. And that was the first time that a brutal, extreme video was shown on MTV during the day, because it was on the news. And do you remember Adam Curry?
Yeah.
He was like, all kind of sarcastic, like, don't blink, this is a video, and then they show it.
Wow.
And yeah, so it made the news.
That's awesome.
In Canada, it got played frame by frame, and they had big political discussions about it. We're like, you're not supposed to do that.
No, you don't do that.
Yeah, fucking Hitler's in
there. Oh, my God.
Yeah, then like an amputated arm the next
frame.
Oh,
my God. Let's do that. Let's go watch it now.
Yeah, as long as the Wi-Fi works, I'll bring it up on YouTube.
Fantastic. I recommend you all go and watch it too. So off you go. Check it out. Thanks for talking.
Collateral damage. Look on YouTube.
Thanks for that. Catch you soon.
All right.
Cheers.